to my first ever artist talk.
My little beauty pigs. So my name is Elise Campbell and I made these five mushrooms. These ones here were made by mostly the students in my workshop that I did. So and they were much more nicely displayed before we used this wall as a projector. So welcome and really, really thank you. It's nice that there's just a handful of you that is better than the alternative. So I actually, like, the TLDR is didn't go to art school. None of that, like, opposite to Curtis. But I actually used to always skip my art class in high school. I'd go and do, like, drugs in the woods. Now here I am doing shrooms in Chester. It all comes around. But I thought that art was painting, drawing, sculpture. Very naive, and I have since learned other things, which is great. I was interested in performance art. Oh, I would have just called it drama. I would lie to like anyone and their mother in order to secure a part that I wanted, and I probably would be a dancer in another life. And I will still sometimes with enough gin do a performance, but that's not going to happen now, I'm sorry. Well, I did grow up with siblings who were super artistic. I have four siblings, and they're all just really creative and capable, and it made me feel like a black sheep. My mom would say, oh, your art is your ability to be socially friendly. And I was like, thanks, Mom. Right. But I don't know. I just was different, and I think that was okay. And then, after high school, I went to Simon Fraser University in Burnaby, and I got an English degree, and I just started to have this inclination to make something. And so I actually got into cake decorating. I was really, really bad at it. I ended up going to pastry school because I was really interested in baking, and I thought I wanted to be like a cake decorator, but it just didn't really pan out. I still do bake and use baking as my fallback, but when I was in my late 20s, I got pregnant with my first baby, and I suddenly had a need to make things, to like wrap her in warm things in the middle of July when she was born. So I started crocheting. I was just like nesting, and I just started crocheting everything. And then I moved on to the more accessories for women. And at one point, my dear sister, my older sister, who is an incredible knitter, came to visit me, and she brought a little bit of wool, not yarn, but sheep's wool, and a foam pad and a barbed needle, and was like, you have to try needle felting. And I was like, okay. And so I tried it, and I was like poking. Needle felting is when you take sheep's wool and poke it with a barbed needle to compress the wool together to make it form. And you can do that in sculpture or you can do it flat. So I poked, and I made this octopus. I just kind of like spread its legs to be tentacles, and I put a pink hat on it, and it was so ugly. And I was like, I hate this. This is not for me. I'm going to stick to what I know with crochet. But she persisted, and she sent me a little kit, and the kit was like how to make owls. And so I made an owl, and then I made like 30 owls, and I couldn't stop making owls. And I made owls for everybody. And then it just bit me, and I fell in love with it, and it was just this huge spark. The thing I really loved about it was that I found it to be a lot more social than crochet. I wouldn't be like, don't talk to me, I'm counting, or reading a pattern. I could just sit in the living room or at the kitchen table and still maintain conversations. I couldn't like look at people because you have a very sharp needle, but I could talk and listen. So this was in 2015 when this all just started. And then I just really got quite lucky. A local yarn store, there was a woman there who really, for some reason, was loving what I was doing, and so she commissioned me to make things for her. And I didn't know about copyright laws back then, so I was like, sure! So she just pressed me to keep making and to actually teach classes. So I started teaching just kind of simple, like, pumpkins and owls and penguins and things like that. My classes started, they just became kind of more and more popular. I learned about wet felting just online and taught myself how to wet felt, and then I began teaching other people how to wet felt. Wet felting was really it for me. I was like, oh yeah, this is super cool.
Can you explain that?
Yeah, wet felting is, it's the process of creating fabric out of wool, sheep's wool. So it's like fiber, like hair, and you lay it out, and with soapy water and agitation, the fibers will swell, and then they will shrink, and they grab onto each other. You know how our hair is smooth when you feel it down and rough when you go up? Sheep's wool is rough everywhere. There are barbs in every direction. So when it kind of opens with the soapy water, those barbs grab onto each other, and then with the friction, they lock in, and it shrinks. So it's actually, wet felting is the oldest kind of fabric in history. We were doing that before weaving, before spinning, right? Before we had yarn, you were felting. So I just loved it. And my classes were doing well. I started going to like neighboring communities and getting out of yarn stores and into rec centers and old folks' home, and just like random people wanted me to come and teach them stuff that I, you know, barely knew. I was like, oh, yeah, I just learned this. But that gave me an income. Oh, those are my like original little toadstool mushrooms that I made. So things have changed slightly, thankfully. But the income that I got from that, I was able to purchase a drum carder. And a drum carder is how you make bats. And this really changed a lot of things for me. I had more control over my finished product. I could incorporate not only different colors and my own colorways, but I could also incorporate different kinds of material, not just wool. I use silk and hemp and bamboo and all kinds of stuff. And it actually really propelled me to learn more about wool. I wanted to know about different breeds of sheep and how they work with what I want to do, what works well for needle felting, what works well for wet felting. So that was a really fascinating and exciting part, and I'm in the market for a much bigger one now. I was using this today at Worldwide and Public Day.
Yeah.
Alright, so as my teaching began to grow, so did my confidence. And I was approached by our local art gallery to enter the hat show. They were having a hat show, and the theme was hats off to the West Coast. This is on Vancouver Island. And I'd never actually been in an art gallery before, and I had never made a felted hat, but I was like, yeah, sure, I can do that. And you'll have to forgive my pictures, because when I was making them, I didn't know I was going to be here 4 or 5 years later, showing you. So I was like, not documenting. Anyways, I ended up making a hat called Flotsam, and it was based on one of our local beaches. So it's kind of got the beach and the shoreline, and then on the top we have an amphitheater, and so it was like this cave on the top of the hat. And the crazy thing was that this hat won Best Emerging Artist. And that was quite the feather in my hat. I was like, well, really? This crazy, weird thing that I just dreamed up? But the best part was I made another hat called Old Growth. So I the theme with the West Coast, I had the shoreline, and then this is based on old growth forest. And so I was trying to get, you can't see it super well, but almost the look of bark. Mm-hmm. And on the top of the hood, there's these rings that expand, like the rings of a tree. And then there's the little branch coming out with a tiny little leaf and some moss, like from the rainforest. So I was quite, and it's made with the finest merino wool, silk, and yak fiber. It's just like so light and soft, and I was quite proud of this. And it won the People's Choice for the show. And again, I was like, and it sold for a song right away, and I've never seen it again. But that was a moment in my time where I thought, okay, I could be moving towards something that isn't ornaments on a Christmas tree, right? So shortly after this show, the house that we were renting went up for sale, and we had to leave, and we couldn't go anywhere in BC, so we came to Nova Scotia, which is very far away. It was a really hard move because I was just getting my bearing as I was just, I had this like community of people behind me who were like, you can do it. And they just believed in me. And I had it, and I didn't, you know, before I even believed in myself. So to leave all that and come to nothing with nobody was devastating and difficult. I mean, now I'm of course making my own community because that's what I do, and it's okay. In 2019, the summer of 2019, we moved, and I entered a call for an art magazine called Art Ascent, and the theme was gray. And so I, with my low, gray, deep feelings, I made this piece called Nothing to Give. It's made with all Canadian wool, and the center, you can't see the body is like lying down. The center of the body is just empty hole. You can see through it, there's nothing in there. And so it was accepted, and it earned the title of Distinguished Artist. And that was really great for me. So I realized that these calls are actually something that help me to improve my practice and my technique and abilities. So the following summer, 2020, I responded to a call from the Lunenburg School of the Arts. And that one was, they wanted to pay tribute to the humble cod, the Atlantic cod. And I was like, that sounds cool, I've never made a fish. And this cod was pretty monumental. I did things that I'd never done. So I nuno felted, which is, there's kind of a few kinds of felting, and nuno felting is the process of combining your wool fibers to a fabric. And so the fabric, typically silk, is what I use. The fabric won't shrink, but because the wool shrinks, it ruches it, so you get this whole new look of fabric and new texture, and it's amazing. I really love it. So I did nuno felting, and I dyed it, and I never dyed anything. So the fins are what you can, that's what is the nuno felt. And I had created my own resist. Basically, it's a vessel, and my vessels were typically like a rectangle or a bowl, like a circle. So this was like a fish. And I just felt like it, like almost like Curtis said, it was something, it was my own, not something that I was kind of copying or trying to emulate. It was completely mine. I mean, so this was, it was huge for me. I was like, wow, look what I can do. And so I continued that summer with dyeing. I really got into dyeing silk. And I started off like, this is all one piece of fabric. So I was teaching myself, and I have been continuing to teach myself how to change, using over dyeing, different techniques to get just different tones and values. And so what I do is I take the silk that I dye, and then I will felt with it. So that same summer, I earned a scholarship for a summer long workshop with my felting idol, Fiona Duthie. She's like, in like felting, she's like the queen. So the funny thing is that she lives on Salt Spring Island and in BC, and I lived in Ladysmith, and she was only a short ferry ride from my home. And at the time, I wasn't at the right level. I didn't know about her. And then when I moved to Nova Scotia, she ended up giving me a scholarship for her summer-long workshop, which was creating felted garments using linino felting. I learned a lot about structure and layout. The way you lay out your wool matters. Shrinkage is huge, and drape design. This vest is kind of modeled after the colors in Inverness. This summer of 2021, this was 2020, we went to Cape Breton for the first time, and I just loved Inverness so much, with like the red sand and the beautiful rocks that were scattered, and then the deep color of the ocean. And I continued to take the things I learned in her workshop and make more garments, using my silk and pre-felts, and then my pictures got better after many years. This is called watercolor cape, and it's actually made almost with all Nova Scotian wool. It's a silk fabric that I dyed, and then Taproot Fiber Lab in Wolfville, they have a sheet, like they process all their wool there. So all of the kind of sheer light area is all Nova Scotian lamb's wool, so it's super soft. There's a little bit of merino around the darker edges. And this is just to show how much my work shrinks. This hat was made on this, it's called a resist. It's actually this floor underlay from Home Depot, but it starts out that big. I lay out my wool fine and then my silk on top, and then it is hours of working it down, and shaping it. Those are my feet, my woolly slippers. So following the year, we're now at last year, I heard another call from the Annapolis Valley Public Royal Gardens, and they were looking for installation art in their gardens, and I was like, it would be amazing to make like huge butterfly wings that you could stand in front of and pose and be like, I'm a butterfly. But then I didn't stop there. I said, it should really be like the life cycle of a butterfly, and it's got to be a monarch because we have to save the monarchs. So I created the life cycle of the monarch butterfly, which started with the egg on a milkweed leaf. And I actually just made this slideshow yesterday, so I don't have all my photos. Like, they're at home, and I made it here. So there's my towel. And the larva, the caterpillar, crawls out of its egg, eats the leaf, grows big, and then the caterpillar forms its chrysalis on the milkweed plant, and then once it has ripened to the right age, it comes out and becomes a beautiful butterfly. And this is like, the pieces are like, they're like this, they're huge, and that is taller than me. This project was like pretty epic for me, like scale-wise, technical-wise, and it ended up not landing because I had huge trouble with the wings. I wasn't able to get them to stand structurally. I used like hardening agents. I tried to make a cage for them to be sewn to, and I didn't feel like they would survive living in the gardens for a summer outside. So I had to pull out of the project, and it was pretty devastating to me. I felt very much like a failure, but I had something else coming up, so I could not just keep working on it. So I pulled out, and now the series is sitting in the corner of shame in my finished studio at home. But following that, I was awarded a grant from the Canada Council of the Arts to do a creation, make felted seaweed. I don't know why they gave that to me, but they did, and I had a blast. I really loved working with these colors. Like, these are not colors that I've typically worked with. I use viscose and fine wool, basically. Viscose is just like a shiny vegetable plant. so this is bladderwrack. Again, I don't have all my photos from this series. This is a felty fingers. It's a oyster sieve. It's an invasive species, but I really like it. We don't have this in BC the way that you guys have it here. It's great, and that's another bladderwrack piece. So, but receiving that grant really bolstered my confidence and made me feel like, yes, I have to keep pushing for this, and I only do it on the side. Like, I could do that full time and I could do this full time, but typically it's just in the evenings and whatever time I can find. Last fall I was accepted to VANS. They have a program called New Grads. So in spite of not being a new graduate, because I never went to art school, they had me in, and it was incredible. We all had studio space up underneath, and we had weekly professional development sessions, and we had a great mentor who just worked alongside us, and so it was super busy, but it was a great experience for me. We culminated the semester with making a zine, so everybody kind of would draw or paint and then make some copies, prints, and I couldn't do that, so I just made one large abstract piece and cut it up, so we all got a piece of each other's art to bring home. So just kind of earlier this year, before the residency started, I started being interested in my work as, like, how it is separate and connected, how it starts off as fiber, and then I bring it together. And there's this technique in felting called stained glass felting, and it's where you make a pre-felt, and then you cut it up. Like this, for example, I cut into a heart, and then you cut it up again and separate it and felt it back together. And so I was just starting to work with that. And so this is a crab that I made for the Peggy's Cove Festival of the Arts. I have a member here in the audience. And so this piece is actually on display right now until tomorrow in Peggy's Cove at the William DeGarth in the garage that he worked in, right across from the gallery. And so that's been something that I was playing with right before the residency started, and it's super interesting, and I know I'm going to continue working with it. It's really different from my typical sculptures or my wearables. This is called Cancer Transposed, and then it goes to a new home tomorrow afternoon, which is really nice. And yeah, and so here we are today. Do you know why this picture is relevant for the residency? Curtis knows. This is at my studio, and it's like the tiniest mushroom right there. It's like a little itty bitty baby mushroom. So I think I'm going over, but my work it has an ugly stage. So it starts off really awkward looking, and then it gets ideally beautified. I don't really have any waste in my work. I don't throw anything out, so I have all my old pieces that, like, are in the box of shame that are not allowed to see the light of day. They get put into pieces as bulk. So this one, you can see there's like this tiny little hedgehog, and there's like a starfish and some other stuff in there. And this is the morel mushroom that's just behind Kristen there. Then I wet felt, it's kind of like a scarf actually, and cut it up and poke it in. This is the crimson wax cap where I've got the base, and it has an armature in it that I make, so it's just wood and wire, and then I wrap it up in wool, felt it nice and strong, and make a skin. That's the wet felting, free felt. And then I bring it all together. So this residency has been just, it's been huge for me to get this time and space to create at home. I have to like take all my stuff out and put it on the kitchen counter and work, and then I have to like put it all away and then make dinner. So not having to do the taking out and putting back actually saves a ton of time. I have been been. I felt so well received here. I felt like, who wants giant woolly mushrooms? But it turns out there are other people like me who want them. It's amazing. And I really am so grateful to have had this opportunity. And it is actually informing. It's been inspirational, and I've got a new project planned for the future that kind of pulls from what I've learned about mushrooms. I'm interested in like matters of the heart and growth and decay and change that mushrooms and other plants kind of go through. So yeah, stay tuned for that in the next few years. Because I wouldn't have been able to make this project in this period of time without this residency. So I will just leave you with this little butt. this is Ursula, and she's feeling cheeky. I'm a member of a Canada Felting group, and we had a call out to make in February to make me laugh was the theme. And basically, I think my kids' butts like always hanging out, make me laugh. So, and she did very well. She received special accolades and ended up in an international felting magazine. So, yeah, there she is. And that's it. Thanks for taking the time to listen to me. I know that was a lot of sitting. Any questions? Yeah, Kristen.
I know that like textiles in general are historically female dominated, and because that may be devalued. Did you find that at all? But it seems like you have such a community around you. Did you face any barriers with that, or?
My community was only women. Mm-hmm. So, back then, like I have had, well, a couple, but a man was quite interested in a few of my mushrooms and ended up purchasing the morel. And I think that was, you know, his major desire. So I think there are men who will support the fiber arts, but I really feel that. Like, I don't value my work in the same way as if it was a painting, you know? I have been straddling a little bit of craft versus art for quite some time. And I do feel that I am perhaps moving into more of the art direction, but it's not easy and it's not clear, because I also like making things that are useful and or just a little bit cute, right? Wool is so versatile, and I want to make everything out of wool. If you have the skills and technique and imagination, you can make anything. So I think that, to answer your question, yeah, there's a huge discrepancy, and it is highly female-dominated. But at the same time, I feel such a sisterhood. You know, it might be different if I was, you know, at Worldwide Mitten Public Day, there was only women who came, and Curtis, when he came to visit, but it would be different if there were men. I have male fiber artists that I follow, and they are wonderful. But they're the exception.
Mm-hmm. So. Pretty kind of safe space, maybe.